We will all go through three phases of finance in our lives. Some will get there sooner, some will get there later, but you will have a period of time where you start saving from the very beginning. That's what we call accumulation. You'll get to a point where you're continuing to add more money, but what you're adding today doesn't matter as much as what you've already accumulated. We call that preservation. But eventually, your retirement dollars will exit, and you go through a period of time in terms of what's called distribution. We're going to break that down for you and consider this program because each of those have various goals and different nuances that you need to be aware of. Well, good morning and welcome back to Consider This Program. I am your host, Joe Clark.
I'm Brett Spangler.
Happy to have you along, Brett. Brett is a CPA, part of our team at the Financial Enhancement Group. And today we are tackling taxes. It is tax time, at least for most of us when we're doing the show. You're hearing this for the first time in April. It may be a different period of time, but all of the stuff that we talk about still will remain consistent. And what I want you to understand in this tax rate and in this tax time of conversation is how money needs to look or work as you go about accumulating it and growing it. So we all go through a period of time where we begin to accumulate assets. That's you get your first job, or you are 50 and you just started saving money. It really is not age dependent, but it's accumulation. And that's when we're starting to add money to the accounts. Now, when you're accumulating, when you're putting money in, you essentially have two goals. One is saving the right percentage of your income, and the second is by building tax diversification. So, Brett, when we talk about tax diversification, what does that mean?
So it can be tax deferred. Most people know that from their IRA, or it could be a Roth option where it's tax free. So that way your bucket has both monies that's already you've already paid tax on it and some that you'll pay tax on later.
And what would you tell your kids that why they need tax diversification?
Well, because it's a combination. If you're looking at your situation, obviously, if it's tax deferred, it benefits you more today. If it's a tax like a Roth, then you have both the growth and you've paid the tax and it grows tax free for until forever. So
till your kids have to take it
right.
out. Just like we talked about with the stretch being gone, that's true for the Roth as well. So the kids will have to eventually take the money out. So when we talk about that tax diversification, if you think about the three different buckets of money that you can have, right, you've got the after-tax, that's money that you've already paid taxes on. You've got money, and for those of you that are listening on the radio, I'm actually drawing on a whiteboard. You can watch this if you want to go to our website at yourlifeafterwork.com to get it off the YouTube channel. But you've got money that's after-tax. You've got money that's the Roth, and you've got money that is tax deferred. Now, why do you want to do that? Well, when we go to this cute little thing we call the stair steps, right? This is your tax brackets. These are how they work. So remember, you've got your adjusted gross income less either your itemized or your standard deductions that you're going to be able to take on your return, and that's going to get you down to taxable income, right? And we've talked about this on the show before. We all have a block of money that's taxed at 10%, right? And then you have a block that's taxed at 12%. So Brett, some people will look at me and go, well, Joe, that's only a 2% difference. I will always remind people that's a 20% increase, right?
Correct.
And then you go to 22%. So that's a big jump, right? We're almost doubling from there. Yep. What happens in retirement though, number one, you want to be able to maintain your standard of living when you go to retire. It's not about replacing your income, right? It's about maintaining your standard of living. So I've told you before, if you're 65 years old, you can make about $106,000 and take the standard deduction and wind up in the 12% tax bracket. And as Brett has shared with you already, that means dividends are preferential in their taxes, long-term capital gains really don't even exist, right? I mean, there's beautiful, beautiful things. But Brett, let's say, Barb and I want to go on vacation and I need an extra $20,000 out of an account to be able to take the family on our 50th wedding anniversary vacation. Where does the other $25,000 come from?
So ideally, depending on, if we look at what your tax bracket you're in, ideally, if you can pull that money out after tax, you've already been taxed on it and you pull it out and there's no additional implication on your tax return.
And so that's really where we want to be smart about this, right? You've got when you look at your sources, you've got money that's after tax, you've got money that's Roth, you've got money that's tax deferred. When you go to retire, the first money that you want to pull out is the tax deferred money, all the way up to that line, right? Whatever that line is where you want to be able to withdraw that. Taxes are not going to get cheaper than they are right now, in my opinion. If I could pay taxes on everything at 12%, just sign me up. You know, I would go, I'd head to Star Financial and get a big loan and pay them and be done, right? But you want to pull money out of that account, out of your investment accounts, all the way up to that line. But let's say you need to buy a car, or you're going on that vacation in terms of what we're talking about. That's where you want to be able to take money out of that after-tax account or the Roth account, so that you have no exposure in that 22% bracket. That is really the difference between people successfully retiring and not successful. And you know, that's where we, I don't know, that's where that strategy has to come into play, where sure. You can be safe. So in accumulation, we want to build that tax diversification, right? We want to save the right percentage of our income. People always ask me what that is. Well, the answer is the younger you start, the less you need to save. The older you are, the higher percentage you need to save. Remember, your objective is to replace your standard of living, right? That's right. That is the number one goal. You're not trying to replace your income. You're trying to replace your standard of living when you go to retire. Eventually, you're going to get in the preservation stage. And I think for the preservation stage, I think this is where people wind up on autopilot. And you're just putting your 10% or whatever it is in your 401k, and you look at the statements and you get excited about it. But, you know, we're just putting money in, the employer's match, and, you know, away we go. Preservation is the only time when average return really matters in your investments. And it's hard for people to get that. But if you think about it, and again, I'm drawing on the whiteboard here, but if you think about it, when you're accumulating, right, the market's going up and down. And so you're putting some money in that's maybe low and some money that's high, but you're going to put money in over a period of time. Some people would call that dollar cost averaging. When you're in the preservation stage, though, you still have the market volatility, but as long as you're there at the beginning and you're there at the middle and you're there at the end, nothing changed, right? As long as you had the discipline to be able to get through that part. Distribution is different. Again, you have the volatility of the market, but when you're pulling money out, when the market is down, it doesn't have the opportunity to grow back up. You know, so we were sitting down with somebody the other day, and I guess it was actually this morning. And, you know, I talked to him, if he retired at 70, he could take out somewhere between 3.8 and 4% a year. And Adam and I wouldn't worry about him running out of money. The planning team would feel comfortable with what's going on. And he finally, he knows me pretty well, and he finally looked at me and he goes, do you mean you're only going to average 4%, you know, in terms of what your investment results are going to be? And it's like, well, I hope not. I, you know, at the time of this recording, we're responsible for over $600 million and more than 1,000 families. You know, average return is what we talk about during distribution, or during preservation. But in distribution, you want to talk about how much money you can take out and these ups and downs not bother you. Hopefully the investment performance is greater than that. You're going to have periods of time where the market's up, where the market's down. You know, I have lived through the crash in 87, right? The tech wreck in 2000, the 2008, 2009, you know, great recession. And now here with the COVID, right? So we've seen those periods of time. And when the market is down, Brett, that's not when we want to, where we want to go in and have to pull money out, right? We want to be able to focus on that average return. So when we look at this, you've got your accumulation, your preservation, and your distribution. So when we talk about effective and marginal tax rates, why don't you run people through what the effective rate is? What does that mean?
So the effective rate, if you look at the stair step, you pay some tax at 10, some at 12, maybe some even at 22 and above, and what the average of all the taxes you pay based on your income is, that's your effective rate, your effective tax rate. Your marginal rate is where you end up based on your taxable income on the stair step. So
the last, where your last dollar is
last dollar.
So when you're helping somebody determine where they're going to pull money out of, which account, where they're going to get the income. Do you focus on the effective or the marginal?
Marginal.
Because it's the last dollar, right? So if we choose to put it in an IRA, that's less money you're going to pay taxes on.
Right.
If we choose to put it in an IRA, that's more money you're going to pay taxes on in the future.
Right.
Right. You know, so you really want to sit down that I'm telling you guys, if you do not get to know your tax return, I call it reading your return. If you don't take the time to understand the numbers that are on there, what drives them, where they come from, you're just going to wind up in this life where you're frustrated over what Medicare Part B premiums are. You know, somebody's going to die and you're going to inherit money and you're going to go, how in the world did this happen? Right. I mean, sure. It's, and one of the things that we really didn't hit on this show is the fact that Brett and I are right now, we're both married filing jointly, right? We're both married. There will be a point in time where one of us will not be here, right? Barb will either be filing as a single individual or I will be. And that's just the most probable thing. And as we all know, 70% of the time, it's the woman who's left behind. Men die sooner. But we still want to pay attention to these rates and be as smart about them as we possibly can. And what I see way too often is people just autopilot this. Mm-hmm. And, you know, especially when you get to the preservation stage, you get to the late 40s, mid-50s, right? The kids are out of the house. You're starting to play with grandkids, right? And people just don't focus on their taxes like they really ought to. Yep. So if you came in and had a Next Steps meeting, especially for those of you that are charitably inclined, one of the things is we work on a 10 to 15 year gifting strategy, right? When we're going to use QCDs, qualified charitable distributions, when we're going to use appreciated stock. Mm-hmm. We buy stock sometimes that we know we're going to give away because it's the best way to transfer assets to our kids, right? I mean, there's all these strategies that are there that you just need to really take the time to learn and to get used to. So anyhow, give us a call at 800-928-4001. Get signed up for your Next Steps meeting. It's complimentary. In 90 minutes, we'll give you things you're going to want to consider today, things you're going to want to consider in your future. And if we choose to partner together, what FEG will do for you, whether it's Aaron or Brett or Dean or Jamie, or Grant, we're more than happy to sit down and share some time with you, you know, have a cup of coffee, and let's see what we can do to improve our taxes. 800-928-4001 or yourlifeafterwork.com.